It's Fran, again, with a video about my RCA 45 RPM record player that I showed in a previous video about 45 RPM records. It really is the first home jukebox, a desktop jukebox, if you will, way ahead of its time, and it needs a little bit of work, so I thought I would do a video about it. The original cartridge was totally shot. It seized up. It's got these rails on either side of the stylus to help protect the needle from dropping on the turntable. The cartridge was filled with paraffin, which had leaked out of the cartridge, and the whole thing was just shot. So I had to replace it. I put in a brand new Fahnsteel P51 ceramic cartridge, which is really the only substitute for this kind of player. But the cartridge that I got came with a 2mm stylus. It's 2/1000ths of an inch, which works fine for 78s, but it's a bit broad for later 45s, and the needle just was not staying in the groove, and it's kind of running all over the record. So I ordered a 0.7mm stylus, which I need to put in. There's an interior stop where the return mechanism engages, and so if I put the tone arm all the way to the inside and mark on the blue tape where that is, I will use that as a reference point when I reattach the tone arm. To take off the tone arm, I just have to loosen up a single hex screw. Using some fine tweezers and a small screwdriver to loosen up the mount for the 2mm stylus. And putting in the 0.7mm stylus takes a little bit of finesse and fine touch to get it in there and align it. So put a record on just to test, and I know that the tracking weight for this cartridge is 6 grams, but there's no audio, so I try just putting a little pressure and it comes on, so it's not anywhere near heavy enough. I know it's because the new cartridge is much, much lighter than the original all-metal cartridge. So I tape a nut to the end of the tone arm, and it is playing, but not all completely. It's still skipping out, so it's not quite heavy enough with that on. So I'm just going to take my micro scale and weigh the tone arm with the nut on. And it's 4.8 grams, so it is underweight. So I'm going to add a little bit more weight by putting a little screw head up the tone arm, and I just get it to a point where I get the minimum added weight where it will play reliably. Just trying to get the balance. And that's 6.4, so that's a little bit over, but so around 6 grams is really what we want to shoot for. So I'm taking the weights off. I want to measure the weight of the tone arm as it is. It comes up as 1.8 grams. So I'm going to have to add at least 4 grams of weight to get it to track properly. Got a couple of nuts. Together they weigh 5.7 grams, which is way over, but we'll just have to position them closer to the end of the tone arm, like so. And about 6 grams, so that's about where they'll have to sit on the inside. So I got to remove the tone arm once again. And again, I've marked the position with blue tape, just like before, so I can reset the position. And they do fit interior. They will tuck in about the right place where they should be. And to keep them in place, I'm just going to cut some blue tape, because I want this to be reversible, not permanent. A little finesse to get the tape between the wires and the tone arm. And some very careful poking and pushing with a fine screwdriver to get the tape down around the nuts and really well stuck to the interior of the tone arm, and it's really not going to go anywhere. It should stay put. Now I'm going to reattach the tone arm yet again, and again just lightly finger tighten the that bolt, and then set to the far inside position so I can feel the stop, and then tighten it up. Check it. And again, I'm going to check the total weight here, see what we came up with. 5.7 grams, so a little under, but I think it'll be fine. So, time for another test. Got the record and doesn't quite make it. Doesn't quite make the record, so I have to, I've got to change the alignment, move it in. So I'm going to loosen up the nut a little bit, and I pushed it in to align it with the interior, far interior groove where the auto return would get tripped, and test it again. And spot on. Right where it should be. I'm going to test the return. Just put it on the interior groove. And it triggers. Perfect. It's all lined up. Alignment is perfect. So, there you go. Alright. So now I'm just going to pile up some random records. And see how the autoplay mechanism works and make sure that records get dropped and they play fine and also have a little bit of fun. Okay, so I know what you're saying. Fran, 6 grams of tracking force. It's a record killer. Why would you ever even want to play records on a record player that had such a heavy stylus? Well, it's just the way it is with ceramic cartridge players. You know, before the hi-fi era, tracking force wasn't really measured in grams so much. But yeah, the ceramic cartridges, they're loud and they're cheap, and they're heavy. You know, to operate. It's just part of the mechanics of the ceramic cartridge. But for this record player and other like small record players, I go to the thrift shops and I'm always looking for these 25 cent or 50 cent records. And so I have piles and piles and piles of them. And you know, you can see the condition of like this Beatles record. I Wanna Hold Your Hand. It's a reissue on Capitol, but it is just toasted. It's just the, you know, chunks out of the vinyl. Yeah, this copy of Popcorn by Hot Butter. It's just the, when, these are just, you know, dead records. They're on the last legs. They're not in a condition where you can play it on a hi-fi. They're not jukebox quality. They're sort of, they've gone out to pasture, and so when records are so abused and so, chewed up, and a lot of these records are chewed up because they were owned by kids and they were played on turntables, so with ceramic cartridges exclusively. And so I have so many of these Death Row records, and I collect titles that I like that are beat up just so that I can give them their last plays in a player like the RCA. It's what I do. So, thrift store records. 25 cents to 50 cents. I won't pay more than 50 cents for a thrift store record, but you can get a lot of records even at 50 cents. So, and it's, these records, they're noisy and they skip sometimes, but they still have a lot of life left in them, even on death row. So, no worries about how many hours of enjoyment I'll get out of the RCA. So I noticed that the record didn't drop. And trying it again, record didn't drop. So there was obviously a problem here. I had to check it out. I'm gonna take off the back so that I can access the mechanism which releases the record. I have the turntable on its side so that I can hand turn the mechanism with for the release catch. See, I can, there's the, I can spin. That's the catch for the, and it's a two-stage action. there's this plastic tab that's got this flat top that actually holds the record up. And then above it, there's this metal tab, which when the action happens, the plastic tab, which is holding the record from falling, drops in. At the same time, this metal tab comes out, and that's got a slope on the inside so that it is supposed to be getting between the two records, and it's allowing the lower record to drop and holding on to the record above it for a moment. And then when that the record drops, and then the record above it, as that metal holder is dropping in, the plastic tab's coming out, and then that second record drops down to the slightly lower location. And that so that's how it holds back the stack of records and drops a record. I thought maybe it was the thickness of the vinyl, but I kind of noted that even in the early 50s, the thickness of the vinyl varied a lot. But where these two records really vary isn't in the thickness of the vinyl on the outside, it's the thickness of vinyl on the inside. I can clearly feel that the vinyl on the late 40s record, right near the spindle, is extremely thin, which would account for the way that this mechanism works. So that's interesting. So I can't actually even drop the record on the platter unless I get my hand under it and force the mechanism. It's interesting about the tolerance issues with the center of the record. It's just nothing I ever thought about, you know. Always was aware of the indentation shape of 45s, but never owned an automatic record changer, so I never had the issue of having a record that wouldn't function in it. But obviously, when I guess as records got cheaper and record pressers started using different kinds of processes, the idea of having a tolerance or checking the interior to make sure it would work in an automatic record changer, I'm sure that just went out the window. So it's very interesting, you know, in the early records like this RCA, it's almost like razor thin on the inside. So they really wanted to make sure that the early records, that every single one of them would work in an RCA player. But, you know, after you got to the 70s, record presses, they were probably, they were putting a little bit of an indentation in the middle, but maybe it was more stylistic than actually functional. There was no concern over whether or not it would actually work in a record changer. So, yeah, times they were a-changin', no doubt. One of the things I am doing is I cut a little chunk of foam core, made a little stack of two pieces of quarter-inch foam core, because the way this turntable is designed, there's really nothing to protect the tone arm from slamming down into the plate. If there's no record here, or if the mechanism's off, it can just fall right in here. There's a clip here you can manually hold it. But when you're running it, the tone arm has to be free because there's this automatic mechanism. And if you have the tone arm latched when you're running the mechanism, you're going to bind up the whole works. So I made this little block to sit in here to hold the tone arm so that if it comes off the stand, that the needle doesn't just slam into the onto the base, and it'll basically just rest there and just pad the cartridge. So it doesn't slam down on. So I'm just going to stick that on with a little piece of double-sided tape. All right. Okay, so I found out the reason I was playing Little Willie by the Sweet earlier, and I found the only reason this worked is that this 45 is on Bell, and even though it is a vintage 70s era 45, the die that they were using for Bell, at least this Bell record, does have the impression in the middle for the thinner vinyl. So I'm going to see if this will go with this Mario Lanza record from the 40s and try it out. Yeah. All right. So that is the reason. It's got to have the thin inner circle. Got the schematic for the RCA 45EY3 phono player home jukebox. Very simple. Three tubes. Got a 12AV6 triode. It's actually considered a diode triode because it's got two diodes in there too. So you can use it with super het receivers and auto gain circuits and such, but those diodes are just tied to ground. They're not used in this. This is in the phono, it's just used as a regular triode preamp. And 50C5, it's a beam tetrode, again another radio tube, and driving a output transformer at 250 ohms, which is pretty low. So it's they're running at a higher current, so you know, typically a tube like this would, if you were running into like a 3k ohm load, it would be very low distortion, probably get maybe 2 watts out of it, but driving a 250 ohm coil on the output transformer at 10 times the distortion, so it's made to be loud and cheap and dirty, which it certainly is. And a 35W4 ubiquitous half-wave rectifier, again used in radio sets, super heterodyne receivers and such. And the designations on vacuum tubes, the first number is always the filament voltage. So 12AV6 is 12 volt filament, 50C5 50 volt filament, and 35W4 is 35 volt filament. And made to run off 150 volt mains, because United States. So, all right, so get the trusty calculator in here. All right, so if we add up the 12 volts plus the 50 volts, plus 35 volts for the filaments all in the chain, we get 97 volts. 97 volts. Well, that's not 115, is it? But these tubes, when you put them all together, there's a standard for 150 milliamps. It's generally the standard for the load on the filament chain if you chain them all together. So 150 milliamps. For all the filaments. So you got 12 volt, 50, and 35, which gives you the 97. So 115 volts minus the 97 volts, and we get 18 volts. So you have 18 volt difference. And the reason for that is that these rectifier tubes, they require a minimum series resistance. Usually it's 120 ohm resistor right here. And we can see that in the picture of the chassis, that big wire-wound power resistor right there tacked on to pin 3 of the 35W4. So if we take the 18 volts difference and we use Ohm's law, which is, you know, the current is the voltage divided by the resistance, take the 18 volts divided by 120 ohms, we get 150 milliamps. So there you go. 150 milliamps, they take into consideration that with the series resistor for the loading, it adds up to the correct voltage, 115 volts, if you dropped along all four loads, and if you count the resistor as another filament. The 35W4 also has this tapped filament, so you see pin 6 there. This is because in radios, you have usually, unless it's like a super cheap radio that they're really getting down to a cost, you almost always have a illuminated dial or a panel indicator or some kind of light bulb. And so there's a tap on that filament, so if you do have it in a radio, if you have like a 7.5 volt panel light or back illumination on the dial, then you would use that tap. The mains would go right into the light bulb, and then the other side of the light bulb would go to the pin 4, and there's that 7.5 volt tap there, and the I think pin 6 would then go to the anode. not 100% sure. I think that's the way it goes, because there's a 7.5 volt tap on there. So it would go into 4, and then 6 would go to the anode. But it's not in the phono, because phono doesn't have a pilot light, so they're just bypassing that. But that tap is for there. And I pointed out in the other video, but there's also this cool tap on the volume control. The potentiometer on the volume control has a tap on it with this capacitor, this 0.01 microfarad capacitor and 120K resistor to ground, creating a filter. So if you're playing it at low volume, it rolls off some of the high end. Makes it sound bassier when it's at the lower volumes. So when I replaced the capacitors, all of the audio chain caps were replaced with metal film capacitors. And the dual capacitor, the 4080 mic power condenser, I had an 80 mic cap, an Ichikon cap, and a 47 mic. So I substituted those. 47 is, it's okay. It's not too much over, but if you do a restoration like this, you really don't want to go bonkers with the values on the mains condenser, because these rectifier tubes, they really have a limit to the current that they'll output, and there's a 33 ohm series resistor, right, kind of limit the rate at which that cap charges, and even 80 microfarads is pretty much kind of like pushing it with a 35W4. But if you really, what you thought, oh, I should make that a 200 mic or a 1000 mic, you know, at 200 volts or 250 volts, no, you would just be really killing your rectifier, just pushing it. Because you have to understand that at charging an 80 mic cap at 126 volts, it's 10 times the amount of energy as charging that same value capacitor at 12 volts. So, you know, it's just a good idea to try to get close to the value on the power caps. You can substitute to up or down on the audio range stuff. It's only going to affect tone and sort of the signal performance. But with the power condensers, you don't want to go bonkers crazy with the high voltage caps with the tube rectifier.